Let us all stand and become in our call to worship. From time to time, I want to keep in your remembrance of the reason why we ordered our worship service as we do and why we've incorporated so much of the reading in Scripture into our public worship service. And based on Paul's letter to Timothy, the young pastor, 1 Timothy 4, 13, and really 12, let no one despise your youth. Timothy was a very young pastor in the church of Ephesus, but set an example for believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, in purity. And then verse 13, until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture, to exhortation, and to teaching. So the reason why we, every service, we have Old Testament songs, New Testament, and really we're going to have to do a complete sermon, but also read a portion from the epistles. And this is the way the early church, this is what they did in every worship service. And I'm talking about the church. It's hard for us to realize that at one particular point in time, there was just one church. There weren't no denominations, and there was just one church. And they had many things in common, each local congregation all over the world. And one of the things that they did was they devoted themselves to the public reading of the Scripture. As I talked before, they got this directly from the apostles, real apostles, Peter, Paul, etc. And of course, the apostles got it directly from Jesus. And I want to remind us, I would like us to do certain things in our worship service that clearly connect us with what they call the apostolic church. And it's my prayer that if it were possible for one of the apostles to suddenly appear today or be alive today, they would identify what we're doing. Amen? And I'm thoroughly convinced the way we do church today, the apostle of the first century would have no idea. They would think we're pagans. Amen? And so we want that prayer connection. And so I know it's a little different, but the more I read, the more I study, the more I ask myself, what in the world are we doing? So these are things that I've learned as I've studied the history of the church, how the first century church, how they interpreted the writings of the apostles, and how they did what we call church. Totally different than what we do today, they wouldn't recognize. So this is why we devote so much of our time and our worship to the public reading of the Scripture. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So now that I've done that, before we read today, we want to continue to lift up in sister prayer. Lift up in prayer. Many of you need prayer. Sister Juanita, others sick, afflicted, going through tests, some kind of down and out right now, and we pray for those also. Pray for those who are in grief, you know, loss of loved ones, and so that means pray for myself and my sister and my family. Just very strange, and some of you know what I'm talking about. When you know that both of your parents are grown, you feel like an orphan.
Yeah.
You really do. You feel like an orphan.
Yeah.
And, I went to my father and my mother's grave yesterday, and I was just flooded with memories, and I can't believe that that time has gone.
Yeah.
And I know that they're in the presence of the Lord, but you can't divorce that. Their bodies is in the ground. And so it's sobering. So pray for us. And as I said last week, you don't have to walk on flypaper around us. We're all right with what God has done, but we are still in some grief. Amen?
Amen.
And so please allow us to 3, amen. So you call me and I don't get back with you right away, I'm in grief, amen. But we'll get back with you, amen. Let's go to this Psalm 35, 24 through 28. Let's read it.
Judge me, O Lord, my God, according to your righteousness, and do not let them rejoice over me. Do not let them say in their heart, aha, our desire. Do not let them say, we have swallowed him up. Let those be ashamed and humiliated altogether, who rejoice in my distress. Let those be clothed with shame and dishonor, who magnify themselves over me. Let them shout for joy and rejoice when they hear my invitation. And let them say continually, the Lord be magnified, who delights in the prosperity of the servant. And my tongue shall declare your righteousness and your praise all day long.
Once again, our gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you today in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, we pray that we will humble ourselves today and submit ourselves before you and offer up to you genuine, sincere, heartfelt sacrifice of praise and worship unto you today. Lord, as always, we thank you that you gave us your Son. And Jesus, we thank you that you willingly gave yourself on Calvary's cross. You bore our sins in your body, and they were nailed to the tree with you as you paid the price of our sin fully. The debt has been paid in full. Lord, we thank you because you live, we shall live. Lord, we thank you because when you bodily rose from the dead, he rose with you in newness of life. And Lord, we are so glad that your physical resurrection from the dead is the guarantee of ours that one day either we'll be caught up together with you in the air, with those that have already died and their bodies have been transformed, or those who are alive, body transformed, and caught up to be with the Lord forever and ever. And so, Lord, we thank you for that hope.
Thank you.
And this is the reason why even though we grieve, we don't grieve as others, because we have hope.
Yes.
One day we shall also be raised and be in your presence forever. Lord, we pray for the many needs, the many requests. Lord, you know exactly what they are. And as we read this morning in Sunday school, Jesus told his disciples, the Father knows what you have need of before you even ask. And so, Lord, we know that you know. And so, Lord, we still pray. Lord, meet those needs in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray for our country.
Yes.
And specifically, I pray for the minds of those who profess Christ as Savior. And Lord, I really, really, really believe that the United States of America, it is creeping towards a Nazi Germany. As we are now having discussions, and we're calling them intellectual, reasonable discussions on babies who are born alive, so-called having a discussion with the doctor, whether we're going to let them live or put them down like a horse. And so, Lord, I never thought I'd see the day that we're talking about if a baby is born through a botched abortion, if the baby is born alive, we'll finish the job and kill that boy or that girl because it was the original desire of the mother, quote unquote, for the child not to be born. And fulfilling her wishes that I don't want my daughter, I don't want my son, I want them gone, and even though they've been born alive, we're really talking about putting these children down as a vet will put a dog down. And what's more disturbing to me, Lord, is that we're not in an uproar. We're more concerned about somebody wearing a black face 35 years ago.
Jesus.
Than killing our children.
Teach, Pastor. Amen.
I believe, and I heard this last week, that somebody, a radio commentator, and I believe what he said was true. We're getting to the point that we're going to be killing anyone who is an inconvenience to us.
Jesus.
And so this is where we are going, and
tell the truth.
Just so disappointed in God's people. That we're not in an uproar. That we can't see the handwriting that's on the wall. So Lord, we pray that we are awake and sober. And we will take a stand for what is right and for what is righteous. In order that God will not say to us, as he said through Jeremiah the prophet to Judah, it never entered my mind that you would do this.
Amen. Teach.
Let your own children pass through. Fine. So Lord, wake us up.
Yes, Lord.
Let us be sober-minded. Let us look at this world with the mind of Christ, a biblical worldview. And Lord, we understand that these people, what they lack is Jesus, and they really need to be saved.
Yes, the gospel.
They really need to embrace the gospel of Jesus Christ. He died for us, he was buried, and he rose again. They need to embrace this message to be changed from inside out. Father God, we thank you and praise you today. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
If you can, please, we're going to stand from Scripture in the Old Testament this morning. We'll be Genesis chapter 24, verses 22 through 23. And again, it's Genesis chapter 24, verses 22 through 23. And it reads, when the camels had finished drinking, the man took a gold ring, meaning a half shekel, and two bracelets for her wrist, weighing 10 shekels in gold, and said, whose daughter are you? Please tell me, is there room for us to lodge in your father's house? She said to him, I am the daughter of Bethuel, the son of Milcah, who is the Lord your neighbor. Again she said to him, we have plenty of both straw and feed and room to lodge you. Then the man bowed low and worshiped the Lord. He said, blessed be the Lord, the God of my master Abraham, who has not forsaken his loving kindness and his trust toward my master. As for me, the Lord has guided me in the way to the house of my master's brothers. Then the girl ran and told her mother's household about these things. Amen. The Lord have a blessing to the reading of his word. May you all be seated. Time for you to participate in worship. Our first song this morning. Praise to the Lord the Almighty. Page 210. Praise to the Lord the Almighty.
Praise to the Lord.
Psalm 112, verses 1 through 2. Praise the Lord. How blessed is the man who fears the Lord, who greatly delights in his commandments. His descendants will be mighty on earth. The generations of the upright will be blessed. Wealth and riches are in his house, and his righteousness endures forever. Light arises in the darkness for the upright. He is gracious and compassionate and righteous. It is well with the man who is gracious and lends. He will maintain his cause in judgment, for he will never be shaken. The righteous will be remembered forever. He will not fear evil tidings. His heart is steadfast, trusting in the Lord. His heart is upheld. He will not fear until he looks with satisfaction on his adversary. He has given freely to the poor. His righteousness endures forever. His horn will be exalted in honor. The wicked will see it and be vexed. He will gnash his teeth and melt away. The desire of the wicked will perish. A New Testament scripture to Matthew chapter 17. Matthew 17, verse 14. I'm going to change that to 23 to, no, I'm not going to change.
Oh, Lord, help him.
Yeah. I looked at it on my phone instead of the whiteboard. It looked a little different. All right. Matthew 17, 14. When they came to the crowd, a man came up to Jesus, falling on his knees before him and saying, Lord, have mercy on my son, for he is a lunatic and is very ill. For he often falls into the fire and often into the water. I brought him to your disciples, and they could not cure him. And Jesus answered and said, you unbelieving and perverted generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring him here to me. And Jesus rebuked him, and the demon came out of him, and the boy was cured at once. Then the disciples came to Jesus privately and said, why could we not drive it out? And he said to them, because of the littleness of your faith. For truly I say to you, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible to you. But this kind does not go out except by prayer and faith. Gathering together in Galilee, Jesus said to them, the Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men, and they will kill him, and he will be raised on the third day. And they were deeply grieved. You can see. Thank the Lord for the women's work. So our man says prayer and fasting. Yeah. Have we fasted for the Lord? Or we will. At this time, we're going to have a choir to come minister in song. I can go to God.
song this morning is in our hymnal. It'll be Psalm 213. It says, shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful song. Give thanks to him and praise his name. The song we give, we bring the sacrifice of praise.
Yes, hallelujah.
Matthew chapter 5, 6, 7. We are nearing the end. I don't know where I'm going to be when I finish this, but I'll be someplace in the Word of God.
Just teach the Word.
The Sermon on the Mount is a lengthy lecture given by our Lord Jesus Christ concerning things related to the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of heaven concerns those things related to God's sovereign rule over all things, and most importantly, God's rule over the minds and hearts of his people. The primary enemy of the kingdom of heaven is Satan. Let me say it again. Kingdom of heaven is God's sovereign rule over all things, most importantly, the minds and hearts of his people. And of course, God's people are those who have fully embraced the gospel of Jesus Christ. Jesus died for sins according to the scriptures, was buried, and he bodily rose from the dead on the third day according to the scriptures. This is the gospel. Those who fully embrace this, believe it, real faith, they are part of this kingdom of heaven. And so the primary enemy of that kingdom is Satan, the chief of the fallen angels, whom the scriptures say prowls about like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. I quote 1 Peter 5:8-9, be of sober spirit, be on the alert. Your adversary, the devil, prowls about like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. But resist him firm in faith, knowing that the same experiences of suffering are being accomplished by your brothers who are in the world. Satan's primary method of devouring people of God is he works through his personal servants. Let me say this, he has his own ministers whom the Bible calls false apostles and deceitful workers who appear to be servants of Christ. I quote 2 Corinthians 11:13-15, for such men are false apostles, deceitful workers, disguising themselves as apostles of Christ. No wonder, for even Satan disguised himself as an angel of light. Therefore, it is not surprising if his servants also disguise themselves as servants of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their deeds. It is for this reason Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount, he gave those who are of the kingdom of heaven a stern warning in Matthew 7:15-20, to beware of false prophets. And so we want to turn our minds and hearts to Jesus, stern warning to those who are of the kingdom of heaven, concerning this group that he calls the false prophets. Notice Jesus in Matthew 7:15, beware of the false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. Notice concerning the false prophets, the Lord admonished those of the kingdom to beware. The word beware is a Greek word proseko. In the denotative or the literal sense, it was a word used to describe a ship holding to a direct course or route towards a specific destiny. However, the context or the connotation of this word as used by Jesus in Matthew 7:15 is this. He was given a strong warning to hold straight to the fact or the sobering truth that just as a ship holds a steady course towards its destiny, we must hold to the sobering truth that there are false prophets out there who are out to deceive on behalf of their leader, Satan. So remember the word beware, straight course. Don't deviate from it. true and straight to this fact, that there are false prophets out there, and they are out to deceive. Mm-hmm. The false prophets were a matter of serious concern in the mind of Jesus. It may not be to us, but it was and is to Jesus. Mm-hmm. And I think that should have a great bearing on how we view the false prophet, the false teacher, the phony bishop,
amen,
the deceiving so-called apostle, the so-called prophet, and the so-called prophetess, and other modern-day seers, L.A.-like preachers. Amen? Jesus was and is truly God and truly a sinless man. And so I think what's in his mind takes precedence over what is important in our mind. And in his mind, in Jesus' mind, and in the mind of the God-man, God who became man but never ceased to be God, and the man who is God, one with the Father in all things, and also sinless man, never broke one commandment of God, never committed one sin internally or externally. In other words, Jesus never looked at a woman and said, "Ooh-wee," like a hen did. Amen.
Amen.
Got one amen from the men. Amen. And he never committed a physical sin. So I think what's in his mind should take precedence over what's important in our minds. And in Jesus' mind, it was a serious concern. False prophets destroy the lies, or they destroy lies, both in the spiritual and natural sense, in a merciless way. For Jesus likened the false prophet into a ravenous wolf devouring helpless sheep. And so it is for these reasons Jesus wanted those who are of his kingdom to clearly understand that there are and would be false prophets, and they, those who are of the kingdom, must be aware of them.
Amen. Amen.
Now, as I stated at the end of last Sunday's sermon, I might have lost some of you. Jesus teaching in this Matthew 7, 15 to 20 text and others, where he warned them about false prophets and deceivers. It is better understood if you read some of the first 300 years of the history of the church. In other words, from the period of the last apostle dying, John, up to the Emperor Constantine, read what occurred in the church during those first 300 years. And what you will see is the church of the first 300 years, it was constantly being harassed by false teachers, false so-called prophets, apostles. And so Jesus' warning concerning being aware of these false apostles, false prophets, we call them bishops today, yes I do. Them being aware of what Jesus said, that the whole straight course of the fact that false prophets, they're out there, they're going to come, beware of them. They are ravenous wolves in sheep clothing. Them being aware of what Jesus clearly taught enabled the early church to survive and maintain the essential doctrines of the Orthodox Christian faith. The word Orthodox simply means straight. We don't like straight stuff, and we like to veer off into craziness. We don't want straight doctrine. Just this is straight down the line. No, we want wild, crazy, lunatic foolishness.
Amen.
And then we want to believe that. Now that's the real spiritual stuff. No, that's the lunacy. Amen.
Amen.
We love it.
That's right.
What allowed the early church to stay true to the Orthodox Christian faith, the same essential body of truth that we know we must cling to because we know Christ as Savior. They were able to maintain because they took Jesus' words seriously. Jesus' warning in this text, it not only prepared the church of the first 300 years, but it also, it prepares and enables us to take a stand today on those truths that have been once and for all delivered by Christ through his apostles to the church. Jude 3, beloved, this is the Lord's half-brother Jude, beloved, while I was making every effort to write to you about our common salvation, I felt the necessity to write to you appealing that you contend earnestly for the faith, which was once and for all handed down to saints. And you read Jude, then immediately after he says that, he begins to talk about false teachers who were trying to wipe that away. So this warning of the Lord, it prepares us and enables us to identify these false prophets and these false teachers. And thus we are able to maintain those essential Christian truths that have been once and for all delivered by Christ to his church. Now, if you read the first 300 years of the church, you'll find out that virtually every false doctrine we have today, it started sometime in that first 300 years of the church's existence. The false teaching you see today is the same old false teaching with a slightly different twist. It's the same teaching with just a new overcoat. It's the same stuff with just a little different style. And these false teachers tend to put their own little twist on it. But at the end of the day, it's all the same lies and false teaching.
Well,
you know, the primary doctrine of the Jehovah's Witness is they deny that Jesus had no beginning and no ending, that he is distinct in person from the Father, but yet the same in substance, in essence. In other words, the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, they are the one true and living God.
Amen.
God is a three-person being. He is one being who is three persons. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. They equally share one and the same substance, one and the same might, one and the same power, one and the same of everything that makes God, God. And that's why Jesus could say, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Mm-hmm. Although we are distinct in person, he's saying, we are the same thing. Yes. That's why the Lord could say, hey, if you believe in God, you're doing all right. Jesus says, believe also in me.
Amen.
That's why Jesus could say, whatever the Father can do, I can do. As the Father has life in himself, I have life in myself. Why? Because they share one and the same life.
Yes.
But the Jehovah's Witnesses reject that. And they say, no, Jesus was a created being, a lesser God. He was God's first creation. And I'm just quoting from the Watchtower website. And it's this, unlike any other human, Jesus lived in heaven as a spirit person before he was born on the earth. He was God's first creation. What they mean is God created him. And then it goes on to say he helped in the creation of all other things. Well, the Bible says he created everything.
Yes.
It didn't say he helped. It says by him, for him, and through him, all things that are made were made. It don't say nothing about he helped out doing nothing. Amen. This teaching that we have today, they're probably knocking on somebody's door as I speak. This is not new. It began in the first 300 years of the church to a gentleman by the name of Arius, who taught that Jesus was not truly God or very God, one in essence with the Son, one in essence the Son with the Father, but he was a distinct lesser being created by God. That's an old teaching, an old false doctrine. And unlike the day, the early church stood against it. And unlike the day, they kicked Arius out of the church. They banned him. Why?
because they took Jesus' words and the text of Matthew 7, 15 through 20 seriously, where he warned them of false prophets. Amen?
Amen.
And I can go on and on and on and list you all of these new teachings. They're not new at all. The Solomon says there's nothing new under the sun. It's the same old false doctrine, same old lies of Satan in a new suit of clothing. But underneath, it's the same rotten, festering, decaying, rotten spiritual product.
Yeah, amen.
If the church of the first 300 years had not known the word of Jesus as their guide in dealing with these false teachers, the church would have barely been distinguishable from any of the other pagan false religions of the day. In other words, there would be much confusion, madness, and frenzied nonsense as we see in some certain sections of the church today. Why? Because we don't believe you. We don't believe there are any false prophets out there. Or if they are, we think you can't judge.
Come on, teach. Well, that's a lie.
Said. Now you can't. Who are you to judge? When it's crazy, it's not of God.
Amen.
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
The Bible says God is not the author of confusion. If it's confusing and madness and lunacy, it is not of God. God is not the author of confusion. So if it's confusing, it's not God. It must be the devil. Amen. Jesus taught those of the kingdom to be aware of the false prophets. Look at 15 again. Beware of the false prophets. Now, in the Greek language, he used a specific word. It's the Greek word tone. It's translated in English to the word the. It is a definitive statement. It's the false prophets. Not a false prophet, but the false prophets, plural. And what the Lord is saying is these false prophets are a distinct group. What he's saying is they are a fraternity.
Wow.
The false prophets are a fraternity assembled by Satan. They are a brotherhood assembled by Satan. This is why you'll never hear a false prophet condemning another false prophet.
Well,
you'll never hear one of these phony so-called anointed bishops being critical of another for preaching false doctrine. No, they are a fraternity.
Teach us.
They never expose one another's false doctrine because they are a brotherhood of false prophets and teachers. As a matter of scriptural fact, Jeremiah writes that during his day, the false prophets were a fraternity who borrowed and taught each other's lies.
Wow. Come on, teach.
Notice what Jeremiah says. Let me read what Jeremiah says of the false prophets of his day. Let me read it out the NIV so you really get it clearly. Jeremiah 23:23-27. God says this, "Am I a God nearby, declares the Lord, and not a God far away? Can anyone hide in secret places so that I cannot see him?" It's amazing Jeremiah says that, and we got people saying God don't know when certain stuff happens.
Well,
let me read it again. "Am I a God nearby, declares the Lord, and not a God far away? Can anyone hide in secret places so that I cannot see him?" If there's no place where God cannot see you, then it seems to reason God knows when you drop dead. Amen.
Amen.
But we got a teaching out today. Oh, God don't know. He really? God says, Do I not feel the heaven and the earth, declare the Lord? I have heard what the prophets say who prophesied lies in my name. Mm-hmm. They say they had a dream. I had a dream. Where have we heard that before? Mm-hmm. How long will this continue the hearts of these lying prophets who prophesied the delusions of their own mind? Notice what God says. They think the dream they tell one another will make my people forget my name. Just as their fathers forgot my name through Baal. Notice Jeremiah says they tell each other's dreams.
Yes.
They borrow each other's lies. Why? They are a fraternity of false prophets. These so-called anointed bishops, supposed apostles and prophets, and other supposed anointed ones who profess to be reeking with power, they are a fraternity who share each other's false doctrines and lies, and they share it amongst one another for the express purpose of making the people of God turn away from God and instead follow them.
Amen. Come on, teach.
I'm God's master broker. You're a pile of dirt.
Amen. That's being nice.
That's going back to the dirt. Amen.
Amen.
I'm the anointed seer of God. You're nothing. Amen.
Amen.
But dirt. And you're going back.
Amen.
Let me move on today, y'all. Jesus says, beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. When Jesus said false prophets come in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves, what he's saying is they are masters of deception.
Yes. Yes.
It looked like a sheep, but it's really a wolf. They are masters of deception. On the outside, they appear to be true men of God.
Mm-hmm.
But on the inside, they are as ravenous as a wolf, ripping a sheep apart in a mad feeding frenzy. These phonies can talk preacher talk.
Yes, sir.
They have that preacher inflection in their voices. Yeah. And gawk, shit. And we have healed in the Holy Scripture. They can talk that preacher talk. They can adjust their message to fit the crowd.
Yes, yes.
Just as easily as a chameleon changes its colors to blend in with its surroundings. They have the external appearance of being the real deal, but on the inside they are ravenous wolves. In other words, they do not care about the people, just as a wolf is merciless in ripping a sheep apart. In other words, they have no shame when they ravage the people. There is no shame to their game. And that's why they get on television and tell every kind of lie possible to get you to send your money. Anointed holy water, $29.95. A holy prayer call, $19.95.
Don't forget the Ark of the Covenant.
I haven't heard that one yet, amen. Now remember, when Jesus is speaking these words, they don't have the epistles yet. And so what they know of false prophets, in their mind, it would come from the Old Testament. And the one who spoke the most about false prophets in the Old Testament is Jeremiah. And Jeremiah said, these guys have no shame. There's no shame in their game. They'll do absolutely anything in the name of God. Let me read you what Jeremiah says about them. Jeremiah 6:13-15. For from the least of them, even to the greatest of them, everyone is greedy for gain. Have you heard that before?
Yep, money.
And from the prophet, even the priest, everyone deals falsely. They have healed the brokenness of my people superficially, saying, peace, peace. But there is no peace. God says, but they're ashamed of the abomination they have done. They were not even ashamed at all. They did not even know how to blush. That's what God says.
Wow. Not even how to
blush. God said, they're not ashamed. They don't even know how to blush.
Wow.
Verse 16, Jesus said, you will know them by their fruits. Grapes are not gathered from thorn bushes, nor figs and thistles, are they? It's a rhetorical question. No. Now, let me slow down. I've heard many professed Christians say, we don't know who a false prophet is.
Lies.
We don't know who a phony bishop is. We can't judge. And they quote Matthew 6:1 out of context, judge not, lest ye be judged. That's not talking about dealing with false prophets. That's talking about making a correct judgment by first judging yourself.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
But the Lord says, you will know them by their fruits.
Yes.
The word will in the Greek, it's a modal verb. What that means is you will definitely know who these guys are. You will.
Yes.
No doubt about it. You will know them by their fruits. The fruit of the false prophet, it consists of what they teach and how they live. Jesus reiterates this with an analogy. He said, grapes are not gathered from thorn bushes. A thorn bush is a small tree that has branches on it with many thick needle-like thorns or spikes. And so he says, grapes are not gathered from thorn bushes, nor are figs gathered from thistles. A thistle was and is a plant with many prickly stems and leaves, which feel sort of like sandpaper. If you see a thorn bush producing grapes, if I was you, I wouldn't eat them grapes. Amen? If you see a thistle bush growing figs, I would advise you don't eat those figs. There's something wrong with them.
Yes.
Because thorn bushes do not produce grapes. Thistles don't produce figs. If I see an oak tree, it's supposed to be producing acorns. Now, if I walk in, I'm a squirrel hunter, so if I walk down, I hunt a lot around the acorn tree. So if I walk into the woods and I come to an acorn tree and it's growing apples, I mean, man, you think I'm gonna get one and eat it? There's something wrong.
Right, right.
So the Lord says, you'll know them by their fruits. Look at what they teach and how they live. They have the appearance of being true men of God. They have that ecclesiastical voice. Mm-hmm. They can put on a good show in the pulpit. In other words, entertaining.
Right. Well,
they memorize certain passages of scripture, but they always twist and distort them to get the people under their control and also their money, cash, dollar bills, diamonds, luxury cars, Armani suits, Bruno Maglio, and Salvatore Ferragamo's shoes. But their fruit is rotten. The number one way to detect a false prophet is by what he teaches.
Amen.
These false doctrines normally consist of denying in some form or fashion the sufficiency of the person and redemptive work of Christ through his incarnation in the womb of a virgin named Mary, his life, his death on the cross for sins, and his bodily resurrection from the dead. They deny the sufficiency that is in Jesus. And they always want to make you in some way dependent on them. They deny the sufficiency in Jesus.
Amen.
This is what 2 Peter says, 2 Peter 2:1, when he says this about false prophets. He says, but false prophets also arose among the people, just as there will be false teachers among you, who will secretly introduce destructive heresy, that's false teaching, even denying the master who brought them, bringing swift destruction upon themselves. They deny the sufficiency that is in Jesus Christ, in his death, his burial, and his physical or bodily resurrection from the dead. Let me tell you something. If you have Jesus, you got it all.
Amen. Yeah. Everything.
If you have Jesus, you don't need me. You don't need the guy down the street. You don't need the guy south of me. You definitely. If you have Jesus, you have it all. He's Alpha, Omega, the beginning and the end. He's the first and the last. He is God the Son of God, the Messiah of Israel, the Savior of the Gentiles, the Creator of all things. He upholds all things, the Bible says, by the word of his power. Now, why do you need me?
Amen.
When you have all that, amen.
Yes. Praise our Lord.
But they minimize the sufficiency that is in Jesus.
Amen.
They deny his words. When Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, they say, well, that is true, but. They deny the attributes of God. Psalm 147, 5, great is our Lord and abundant in strength. His understanding is infinite. But they say, God don't know everything. Somebody's lying.
Somebody.
And it's not the scripture, amen?
Amen.
They denied the sufficiency of the scriptures alone, and instead said you must also trust in them. Even though the Bible says you can search all things by searching the scriptures to see if it's so. Amen? Acts 17:11. As far as their personal lives, false prophets are greedy for godless gain, or they love money. 2 Peter 2:3. And in their greed, they will exploit you with false words. They are sensuous in the sexual sense. 2 Peter 2:2. Many will follow their sensuality. They're pretty boys.
Tell the truth.
Pretty cute boys.
Prissy.
And normally they are surrounded by weak-minded, silly women who are full of various lusts.
That's right.
Who never learn and are never able to come to the knowledge of the truth.
Wow.
Come on, teach. That's what the Bible said.
Now, I know that's not a good statement nowadays, because this is the day of the woman, right? You can be a man. Isn't it amazing we're living in a day and age in which many women today are trying to prove their womanhood by being as much as they can like a man?
Amen.
I'm proving my womanhood to you by letting you know I can do whatever a man can do.
That's right.
It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to prove my manhood by how feminine I can be. Because I don't have a feminine side. Don't look for one. You should show your feminine side. Don't have no feminine side. Amen. You should be more, I am what I am. Amen. My pastor Henry Wallace said he's going to be preaching in a few weeks. Hey, what you see right now is the way I'm going into glory. Amen. I'm a guy.
Hallelujah.
I like guys' stuff.
Yes.
I like to look like a guy.
Yeah.
I like to smell like a guy.
Amen.
I like to act like a guy.
Amen.
Why? God made me a guy. Let me read this to you when Paul talks about these women and these false teachers. For of this sort are they who creep into houses and lead captive silly women, laid with sins, laid away with dire lusts, ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. He goes on to say in verse 8, now just as Jannes and Jambres withstood Moses, so do these also resist the truth. Men of corrupt minds reprobate concerning the faith. They desire people to be disciples of them rather than Jesus. Acts 20:29-30, Paul says, I know that after my departure, savage wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. And from among your own selves, men will arise, speaking perverse things to draw away disciples after themselves. When you see pastors preaching to so-called anointed bishops and apostles and prophets who claim to be just reeking with spiritual power, constantly doing these things, you can know what they are. Because Jesus said in Matthew 7:16, you will know them by their fruits. So we can know who they are. Amen? Verse 17. So every good tree bears good fruit, but the bad tree bears bad fruit. The analogy the Lord makes is very clear. That is, every good tree, every healthy tree, it always produces good fruit. A healthy apple tree can't help but produce good, crisp, sweet apples. Mm-hmm. Likewise, those that have been truly called by God, they will produce a healthy spiritual fruit. Amen?
Amen.
They will fulfill 2 Timothy 4:2, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with great patience and doctrine. They will do this because they believe another verse. 2 Timothy 3:16-17. All scripture is inspired by God, or God breathed and profitable for teaching, reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be equipped for every good work. The method they use to prepare themselves is 2 Timothy 2:15. Be diligent to present yourself approved to God as a workman who does not need to be ashamed, handling accurately or rightly dividing the word of truth. And they will oversee the flock of God as true shepherds of God. They will guard the flock. They will guard the sheep. They will guard the church. Acts 20:28, be on guard for yourselves and for all the flock, among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to shepherd the church of God, which he purchased with his own blood.
Amen.
Those who are truly called will produce true spiritual fruit.
Amen.
A good apple tree cannot help but produce good apples.
Uh-huh.
But the opposite is also true. A bad tree always going to produce bad fruit. The reason why a tree is producing rotten apples is because the tree is rotten.
Amen. Right.
Something wrong with the tree.
Mm-hmm.
False teachers and false apostles will always produce unhealthy spiritual fruit. And if you eat it, it'll make you spiritually sick.
Amen.
These false teachers who are wolves in sheep clothing, they always end up producing that which promotes spiritual disease of various kinds. They can't help themselves. They always will end up preaching false. They can't help themselves.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, they can be a phony for a while. It always comes out.
Yeah.
They cannot help themselves.
Yes.
Why? A bad tree can only produce bad fruit. Mm-hmm. And if you eat it, it'll make you sick.
Yeah.
Mm. Amen.
Verse 18, a good tree cannot produce bad fruit, nor can a bad tree produce good fruit. This, to me, this is one of the most profound teachings about false teachers in the Bible. That is this. It is impossible for a true man of God to produce false doctrines and raggy spiritual lies. Jesus makes this plain through this analogy, which says, a good tree cannot produce bad fruit. I don't know about that, Pastor. Let me read you what Jesus said again. A good tree cannot. He didn't say, maybe a good tree, maybe, I don't know. Well, I seen some guy. No, Jesus said, in reference to false teachers and true teachers of the Word of God, a good tree cannot produce bad fruit. The true man of God will never end his preaching career, and teaching foolishness, which makes spiritual shipwreck of the life of the people. Well, he started out so good.
Right.
Why didn't he finish?
Well,
he just told you, a good tree cannot produce bad fruit, nor can a bad tree produce good fruit.
Amen.
So where you was always?
He started out right, but look how he ended.
That's where he was always at.
There's something wrong here. Because Jesus says a good tree can't bring forth this bad fruit. Matter of fact, he says it can't. And then 19. I move fast today.
It's all right.
Got a presentation. I move fast today. Verse 19. Every tree that does not what? Bear good fruit is what? Jesus clearly states the end of these false prophets is hell.
Amen.
Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into where? The fire. Jesus' half-brother, was moved by the Spirit to say false teachers and false prophets. There's a special place in hell reserved for them.
Wow.
Let me read Jude 12:13. These are men who are hidden reefs in your love feast when they feast with you without fear, caring for themselves, clouds without water, carried along by winds, autumn trees without fruit, doubly dead, uprooted, wild waves of the sea, casting up their own shame like foam, wandering stars. And then Jude says, for whom the black darkness has been reserved forever. God has a special place in the darkness of hell for these guys.
They are destined, the Bible says, to hell. You believe that, Pastor? I sure do. When you see a man go off and just keep going further and further and further and further into more gross lunatic doctrines, the only thing you're telling me is you've been reserved to hell.
Amen. Amen.
Because the scriptures say these false teachers are reserved for the black darkness forever.
Teach.
And that's what Jesus said. Verse 20, so then you will know them by their fruits. Why does he say the same thing twice? In verse 16, what did he say? You will know them by their fruits. Then in verse 20, the Lord says the same thing. So then, you will know them by their fruits. Jesus said it twice because he really wanted his people to know that they can definitely know who these false prophets and teachers are.
Amen.
You will know them by their fruits.
Amen.
It is amazing to me that even though Jesus stated this twice in the same passage, most Christians today believe it is utterly impossible to know if a man is the real deal man of God or a phony.
Foolishness.
I've had these arguments with my colleagues. And though you can't know them, you will know them.
Amen.
Jesus. By their fruits.
Amen.
Now, Pastor got a harem of women. You will know them by their fruits. Amen. He wants the sisters of the church to make him a pie, or they make their husband a pie. So then, you will know them by their fruits. Am I in the house today?
Yes.
But pastors say, Lord told him, we all need to give a doorknob offering. What's that? Count up all the doorknobs in your house and give $5 for each one. So then, you will know them by their fruits. Jesus showed up in my room last night and talked to me personally and told me to tell you, even though Apostle Paul says, I'm the last one to sing. And last of all, sing by me. When he said Jesus showed up, so then,
he's a liar.
You will know them by their fruit. Well, Pastor said, even though you can't find this in the Bible, it's true because he says truth. So then, you will know them by their fruit. We know Bishop is teaching us, God really don't know when you die, even though the Bible says God's understanding is infinite, and there's nothing he does not see. His presence fills the heaven and earth. But Bishop said, God don't know everything. He doesn't know when I die until he gets a memo from an angel. So then,
Bishop's a liar.
You will know them by your fruit. Well, Pat said you got to get baptized 3 times to be saved. You got to go down once for the Father, another for the Son, another for the Spirit. If you're not dipped 3 times, you're not going to make it. So then, you will know them by their fruits.
Yes.
Brother JoJo said, you know, it's Christ, plus you got to do this, you got to do that, you got to fall out on the floor. If you don't do these things, you cannot be saved. So then, you will know them by their fruits. Amen. Well, Pastor, he knocked folks out every service. Had the whole church slayed in the spirit, and then he slayed himself. I've seen that. They just slayed. You ever see that? I've seen these guys slay themselves in the So then, you will know them by their fruits. y'all better give me $500,000 if you don't, it's because you're full of the devil. So then, you will know them by their fruits. Pastor got up in the pulpit and said he could have anybody's wife.
Oh no.
So then, you will know them.
Come on,
by their fruits.
Come on, tell
the truth. Pastor got a boyfriend too. So then, you will know them by their fruits.
Come on, leave no stone unturned. Come on.
We can know who these guys are.
Yes.
And so I'm 60. I'm too old to change. Amen. I agree with my Pastor Wallace. What you see is what you get. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going in the glory just like this. Might get worse. Amen. But I don't have time to back it up now and start teaching and doing, you know. And, you know, I'm way past trying to tell you the soft step and word of God.
Yeah.
If Jesus said you can know they are, you can know exactly
who they are.
The problem is you don't really believe what Jesus has spoken.
Yes. Amen. Yes.
But I do.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
But I was not moved when Tyler Perry gave a meal and enslaved T.D. Jakes.
Do you expect
it? Didn't do a thing for me. The only thing that made you remember, you will know them.
By their fruits.
By their fruits. Amen. When they lifted up and did any long on that throne and marched him around and wrapped that tour, and they said, come out of Auschwitz, they found him on the railroad track and never been opened, and they opened up and wrapped him and marched him around as King Eddie, you will know them by their fruits. When Benny Hinn is knocking folks out with his suit coat, you will know them by their fruits. I think I'm going to end it right here. Some of y'all look like you're ready to gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the word of the Lord today. I pray that we take heed to the word of Jesus and hold straight to the fact that there will be false prophets.
Yes.
And there are false prophets. They are dangerous. They are wolves in sheep's clothing. They are merciless. They have no shame. We know them by their fruits. They're greedy. They're sensuous, tricky, cunning. Lord, help us to have discernment about these types, because we want to maintain and stay true to the faith, as Jude says, has been once and for all delivered to the saints. Help us to stand on this word of God and not be moved away from it. Lord, give us your mind. You were serious about this, and we should be also.
Yeah. Amen.
Perhaps there's one today you are not saved. Christ as your Savior. There's only one way to be saved, and it is the gospel of Jesus Christ. Believing it and accepting it by repentance, true sorrow for sin, and fully embracing Jesus Christ as he died for your sins on the cross, was buried, and bodily rose from the dead on the third day. This is the gospel. There is no other way to be saved apart from this gospel. Amen?
Amen.
There's one today, and we'd like all the workers just to pray with you. Just give you the message of the gospel in order that you can be saved. If there's one today, would you raise your hand? Perhaps there's another, you're saved, you believe God wants you to be a part of this fellowship, you've read the doctrine, and you've heard it preaching for a while, and you believe God wants you to be here. If there's one, would you raise your hand today? Father God, we praise you and thank you for all things today. Father, we are so glad you gave us Jesus. Yes. Lord, make him number one. Help him stay number one of everything in our lives. Lord, help us to understand you're in Christ. You lack nothing. If you're in Jesus, you lack nothing. If you're in Jesus, you don't have to borrow just a pew. If you're in Jesus, you don't have to fall out. If you're in Jesus, you don't have to do all this other stuff because you are complete in him. And he is sufficient for all things. Father God, we praise you and thank you. In Jesus' name, take God's people say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Fellowship this coming Saturday, February the 16th at 4 p.m.
Please see Minister Fonzie Palmer or Sister Lamar Palmer for more information. If you'd like to purchase a Made in His Image t-shirt, please see myself or the Acorn to place your order. Costs for the shirts are various based on the size that you need. They are listed in your bulletin. Please note all payments must be given to Brother Acorn before leaving today. And we've been blessed to be able to provide a t-shirt, so if you're able to get one, please contact me and my wife will be taking orders as well. We will need several men to help set up for the Made in His Image conference. The setup crew will meet at the church on Friday, February 22nd at 7 p.m. Then we'll restore the sanctuary after the conference. You please see me if you're able to help. The ladies are also welcome to help as well. And this one is the color coordination I'm not the guy. So if any ladies want to come out and help, make sure you got it looking nice, pink, and green to come out. And you don't have to do any labor, but you can point and tell them. We're now collecting diapers for Pregnancy Support and the Alliance Pregnancy Center. They're in the sizes 2, 3, and 4. Diapers may be brought into the church at any time between now and February 23rd. We thank you for your generosity, so bring diapers in. Ladies, if you will be participating in next Sunday's Moms in Touch 24/7 prayer, please see Sister Kinlow for important information. And the Family Life Weekend to Remember, marriage conference is scheduled for March 8th through March 10th, 2019 at the Akron Fairlawn Hilton. You can register at familylife.com/weekend-to-remember to receive a discount. Use the group code LOVEFOREVER. And my wife and I have been going to this conference for about 5 years now. I did pass out to a couple couples, so we'll put love wherever we need one, see me. It's an excellent opportunity just to go and just spend time with your spouse. And if you've been married a long time, a short period of time, it's a good opportunity just to meet other couples. I think the 1 year we've got a couple that have been married for 60 years, and the one couple has only been married for 3 days. So, I heard that pastor. Also, we have a special prayer request. Please pray for Deacon Brady Stewart. He will be having surgery this coming Friday morning, so please be sure to look him up. That is your announcement. And then give us about 5 minutes. We're going to set up for Sarah to do a quick presentation to our congregation for child ministry and fellowship. Thank you.